Dr Bajaj, I'm a developmental pediatrician. My main role is around assessing and managing developmental problems such as autism, ADHD, dyspraxia, tics, Tourette's, and behavioral and sleep problems. ADHD is a neurodevelopmental condition characterized by inattention, hyperactivity, and impulsivity. The general prevalence of ADHD is estimated at around 5 to 9% in the population. A key element of ADHD is functional impairment across two or more domains, most often in school and at home. As a result, ADHD can limit academic, interpersonal, and occupational achievements, and can also lead to greater risk-taking behaviors and accidents. Additionally, patients with ADHD are more likely to have coexisting psychiatric disorders such as oppositional defiant disorder, conduct disorder, substance abuse, and possibly mood disorders. A common misconception reinforced by the media is that ADHD is not a real condition or is overdiagnosed. ADHD is multifactorial and caused by genetic and environmental factors. Genetics plays an outsized role, and ADHD is known to run in the family. Low birth weight and maternal smoking have the strongest evidence for association with ADHD. The other risk factors include poverty, lead exposure, iron deficiency, maternal alcohol intake during pregnancy, and psychosocial adversities. At a biological level, ADHD may result from a dysfunction of neurotransmitters such as norepinephrine and dopamine in the brain responsible for transmitting the informations. ADHD is 4 times more common in boys. Girls are more prone to be inattentive type and are hard to pick up. Symptoms begin in early childhood but often persist into adult life. A child may present with predominantly hyperactive impulsive type, where the presenting complaints include squirming rather than sitting, running around and interrupting, or predominantly inattentive type, where children often present later in childhood or adolescence with symptoms such as failure to follow directions, making careless mistakes, being forgetful, and having difficulty in organizing tasks. Or they may present with combined type, which is the most common form and is characterized by both hyperactive and disruptive behaviors, as well as difficulty sustaining attention. An interview of the developmental history and evaluation, including direct behavioral observation of the child, such as fidgeting, not paying attention, interrupting others, continues to be the mainstay of the diagnosis of ADHD. The use of rating scales from multiple sources enriches the process of evaluation. DSM-5 diagnostic criteria is used to reach to a diagnosis. There is no formal laboratory or imaging study, and diagnosis is mainly clinical. Treatment is often multimodal, incorporating psychosocial interventions together with medication, and should be individualized. Psychological interventions for ADHD include a range of cognitive and behavioral approaches, including cognitive behavioral therapy, behavioral interventions, parent training, cognitive training, and social skills training. While there is no cure for ADHD, medication can have positive effects on controlling the symptoms. As with all the pharmacological treatments in medicine, the risks and benefits need consideration before initiating a suitable medication. Treatment improves not just the core ADHD symptom, but overall quality of life by improving the resultant functional impairments. The stimulant medication, which are the first line medication, can be effective in up to 85% of the patients. If the child or young person's behavioral problems are suggestive of ADHD and are causing an adverse impact on their development or family life, consider contacting through the hospital. The ADHD specific questionnaires and screening forms would be sent out to be completed by the parents and school staff prior to the clinical appointment.